Hello, everyone, and welcome to Fast Charge, episode 89. I'm your host, Dom, joined as usual by Lewis and Toddy. And for the second week in a row, we have Chris with us because we are doing our second Pixel 6 deep dive now that we're actually allowed to tell you everything. Before that, we're going to talk about the Honor 50, which I have in my hands right here. This got its European, or actually its global, launch this week with Google. An actual Honor phone with Google that you could go out and buy.
What year is it?
You're in North America, in which case you still can't. Yeah, I mean, we can party like it's 2019 all over again. It's very exciting. Yeah, so I'm going to run you through what I think of this phone. I've been playing around with it for the last week or so, so you're going to get my thoughts on that. Then we are going to turn to the Sony Xperia Pro-I, which, if you missed it, is the surprise Sony phone that got announced just this week. They'd announced a couple of weeks ago they were going to hold an event, and we were all a bit confused and had no idea what phone it was going to be, what was coming. Thought it might be something pro-ish, but this is not the phone we were expecting. This is not what we thought. It's a very interesting device that's all about the camera, and sees Sony just kind of doubling down on the niche that it's put itself in, for better or worse. And then finally, as I mentioned earlier, we are going to come back to all things Pixel 6. We spoke about the 6 and the 6 Pro last week, but now Toddy and Chris have been playing around these phones for a good week and a half or so. We are out of the review embargo, so we're allowed to give you our full final thoughts on Google's new Pixel hardware and Android 12 and how that shakes up the Android ecosystem essentially going forward, because it's always a pretty big splash when the new Pixels arrive, as they sort of set the default for what an Android device is to some extent. Right, before that, here are the other bits and pieces that have happened this week. First up, still on Android, Android 12L. That is the name of the sort of half-step Android upgrade that Google has lifted the lid off through a developer preview now. Entering developer preview, it's going to go through betas in spring. This is actually the first big half-step upgrade we've had, I think, since 8.1, 4 years ago. So it is a bit of a big deal. What this update is all about is tablets and foldables. So the L stands for large screen, we think. I don't think Google's actually confirmed that either way. That's sort of what everyone's assuming. It's just large. Yeah, this is for big screen devices. It includes a lot more baked in split screen functionality, such that any app will be able to be split screened regardless of whether the developer builds in support. Things like having dual columns for notifications and the control center, and some other bits and pieces that will basically hopefully improve the Android tablet experience, which we've spoken about a lot. There's a lot launching, so it makes sense Google is finally turning its eye to that. But also foldables, which have kind of been ignored by Android itself for a while. Obviously, this fuels all the speculation that we're getting a Pixel Fold at some point. What it does mean for that is you can stop looking for that to launch this year, because it's hard to imagine that Google is working on software just for foldables, but will launch a foldable before it finishes that software. So yeah, look for a Pixel Fold maybe next spring. I/O is usually in May. I would probably think I/O now looks like a safe bet for the Pixel Foldable to arrive, but we'll see. Okay, Qualcomm has also had a busy week. We're still waiting for the big Snapdragon 898 or whatever it's going to be called to launch late at the end of next month. At the end of November is when the Snapdragon Summit takes place. But in the meantime, Qualcomm just dumped 4 chipsets out this week, which I think is the most I've ever seen them announce in one go in terms of phone chips. It often does 2 at a time, but 4 all at once was a bit of a go. They are the Snapdragon 778 Plus, or maybe it's the 778G Plus. I lose track of where you get the Gs and where you don't. This is a funny one, because the 778G was only 2 months ago, I think, and this is the Plus version of that. It's got slightly faster CPU and GPU clock speeds. That is it. It's otherwise the same chip. There's the Snapdragon 695, which is just another in the 6 series, but with 5G and some solid specs. There's the 680 4G, which is an interesting one, because it is still a kind of mid-range chip, but it's only 4G, which we thought Qualcomm might be moving away from, but it looks like this is still something it sees in that price bracket worth doing for markets where 5G hasn't taken off yet fully. And then finally, there's a 480 plus, which you guessed it, is the slightly overclocked version of the existing 480. And that one is 5G. So these are all somewhere in the budget to mid-range space. So in a sense, none of them deeply thrilling chips. But
considering we're still in a chip shortage, I am surprised they're doing these very, very incremental ones on these kind of middle of the road chips, like the 778 and the 480. Like,
you have to wonder if in some way it has maybe tweaks that suit better what components they can source or something like that. Otherwise, I equally can't really see the reasoning behind throwing a whole load of new chips out. There's clearly OEM interest, though. They've, as usual, touted the brands already on board. Honor, Xiaomi, Motorola, and Nokia, and Vivo have all already said they're going to make some phones with one or all of these chips in. So, you know, these will appear in phones within the next few months. So keep an eye out for them. Right. Instagram, finally, is letting plebs like us link to things. Very generous of them. Links in stories are now going to be an option. It should be rolling out to everyone, so you may already have it. Check your app. But if not, it will get to you soon. This used to be limited to accounts with 10,000 plus followers or those who were verified. I have honestly just never understood the rationale for not letting everyone post links. Does anyone know why they've capped this before?
I think because before it was a swipe up system, so there was no preview for what you were clicking on, so you only wanted reputable people posting links. But now, the new system, you see the link in the story, so you know what you're clicking on beforehand. So, you know, if you're being Rickrolled or anything stupid like that, you're going to know beforehand that it's a fake website. Or, you know, I think that's my thinking anyway.
Yeah, okay. That's sort of half makes sense. Still, wild that linking is the brand new exciting functionality of social media is rolling out in 2021. But here we are, linking is an Instagram now. What a treat. Two other big launches from this week, not phones. DJI just unveiled the Action 2, one of its new action cameras. This is quite cool. It's a follow-up to the Action, you may have guessed. It's a little modular thing. So the actual Action 2 is just a small little cube, basically, with all lens on one side and touchscreen on the back. But there's modular attachments to give you extra touchscreen or to give you extra battery life, and magnetic mounts and various straps and ways of mounting the camera, all done through magnetic quick release systems. It is quite fun. I have to admit, I bumped into a tech journalist who had one under embargo the other day, and I got to play around with it for a couple minutes, and it is pretty cool. And then finally, Oura, the people who make smart rings are making a new smart ring. The Oura something smart ring 3 is just been announced. It's basically adding a whole load of new sensors in. It's gone from 3 sensors up to 7 sensors. It's going to allow them to do things like real-time heart rate tracking rather than just while you sleep. And they're going to be adding in blood oxygen monitoring and period tracking as well. This is all very good. The flip side of that is they are introducing a membership scheme a la Fitbit, which is a bit more of a downside. And I've got to be honest, it looks like a fairly aggressive membership scheme in that you can use the new Smart Ring 3 without it, but you get very limited data out without paying for the membership. They will give you 6 months free when you buy it. And they're doing some nice things, like if you upgrade from the second gen to the third gen, they'll give you a free lifetime membership. So current owners probably don't need to worry about this, but I do wonder about how appealing it's going to be for new people jumping on board.
Can you buy a 2 and then upgrade to the 3 and then get the free membership?
Is that I don't know. Yeah, maybe now is the time to buy a 2 right now.
It'll work out cheaper than the monthly subscription
in the long run.
Life.
Yeah, as long as you're willing to commit.
How much per month do they want?
I have the figure somewhere. I think it was $5.99 a month.
For some metrics. Which
is pretty steep. And that is before tax if you're in the US. So you'll actually be paying a little bit more than that, but it's 5.99 euros in the EU. I think this feels a bit steep for what they are offering, especially because right now, even a lot of that tracking they've announced is still to come in 2022. You know, when they're saying we're adding blood oxygen monitoring, we're adding it next year. So I'm a bit cautious about this. But equally, I love the idea of these fitness trackers in rings, because I'm a very fussy watch wearer, and none of the sort of smartwatches and fitness tracker watches really appeal to my aesthetic because I'm fussy and annoying. But a ring, I'll happily wear a ring. That's fine.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Do you have to have it on your ring finger? Because I feel like that's the only one with an active pulse going through it, I think.
Yes, there are two, your ring finger and your third. There are two specific fingers they recommend you use it on. I can't remember off the top of my head. But yes, you don't have total freedom to wear it on any finger, or at least they say you'll get worse results if you don't wear it on the correct fingers.
Yeah. I mean, it's something that it's the direction that everyone's going in with the monthly subscriptions. I just feel like they haven't quite got the name brand recognition yet to be able to be like, come on, give us monthly money. Like, we will give you the stuff that we're saying is coming.
They're not Fitbit. No. I also worry, they've maybe just tuned it a little wrong in terms of, you can buy a Fitbit and not pay for Fitbit Premium and have a great experience with that Fitbit. Yeah. And then you pay for Premium if you want to go to the next level, get a bit more data back, get a bit more tailored feedback, some more algorithmic stuff, making recommendations and whatnot. This feels a bit like they've really hamstrung the base data you're going to get so that it's not useless without the subscription, but not really worth the money without the subscription. And that makes me very hesitant. But we'll see. I'm hoping to get one in to have a look at. So we'll see what we think. All right, let's turn to actual phone stuff. So Honor 50, let's start with that. So Honor unveiled the Honor 50 this week for a global release, though you might be thinking we spoke about it a while ago. That's because it was announced in China in July, I think. It was certainly in the summer. So it's been a good few months since Honor unveiled in China. And at the time they said it would get a global release, but we have been waiting and waiting and waiting for that to actually happen. The company hasn't really said why it took them so long to ready it for a global release. I presume the chip shortage is part of that. I imagine that also just the Google situation was another part of it. Getting through certification and stuff like that may have taken a bit longer than they thought it would, especially for their first time round as an independent company. But we have it, an actual Honor phone that you can buy with Google on it. There's actually two, because there's an Honor 50 Lite as well. But that's coming out in a few weeks from now, whereas this one's a bit sooner. This is a mid-range device. It's not a flagship. It's priced at, starting price is £449, €529, which puts it pretty solidly in the mid-range. It's a little bit more than a OnePlus Nord 2, but a little bit less than a OnePlus 9. So it's kind of halfway between those. It's still cheaper than a Pixel 6, which we'll talk about later. It sits in a pretty, fairly funny, I was sort of looking at the other comparison points, and of the phones we really recommend around this price, there aren't very many at that 450, 500 mark. There's quite a few around 600 mm-hmm. and quite a few around 350, 400. But this bit in the middle has been left a little bit vacant in terms of the phones we really rate. And so actually, I think if that is about your budget and it lines up right, this is suddenly a really compelling option, I would say. I've been enjoying it. I think the standouts for me would be the design and the display. And I think other aspects of the phone are either fine or yeah. But design and display, it's a big win on.
I can't help but notice you didn't get the one with the Honor lettering emblazoned across the back in like many reflective kind of refractive angles and stuff, which is a shame. I think that's maybe the most exciting version, probably not the prettiest version, but
it's not the one I'd buy.
No,
I'll say.
Dare to Leap, you know.
I did not get Honor Code, which is the name for that colorway. This is. I think they call it emerald green, but I might be misremembering. It's something green.
Gray from here.
It's a very bluey gray green, but they do call it green. There's also
glass?
Another. I don't think it is. I've been really struggling to find anything confirming either way, but they don't call it glass, so I'm assuming it's not glass. Probably it's not. That feels to me like glass stick, like good enough plastic that I was sat there like, I'm not sure either way. But the fact that I can find nothing anywhere claiming glass tells me it's probably not. But it looks very nice. I like the finish for its style. It's very Honor, that kind of glossy, glassy, if not glass, and colorful and refracts the light in lots of interesting ways. It's a thin phone, which I like a lot, 7.8 millimeters. And although it's fairly sizable, it's a 6.57-inch display, so not enormous, but pretty big. It's only 175 grams, which I think for that size display is pretty lightweight and, like I said, thin as well. So I think this will appease a lot of people who want a big screen but don't want a heavy, bulky phone. They've done a really good job, I think, of finding a balance there, and without having to do the obvious thing, which is put a tiny battery in to make that work. It's still a 4300 milliamp hour battery. It's still a day and a half usage in my experience, so no real battery concerns.
In those same kind of wheelhouse, it makes me think of devices like the Xiaomi 11 Lite 5G or Lite 5G NE that just came out. It kind of feels like it's trying to hit a similar price point as well, actually. Again, one of similar the other price. Few handsets it's, that yeah. kind of around there.
It's a little more expensive than that, but it is similar. That one has sort of fairly straight edges from what I remember, a bit almost iPhone style with the straight edges. This is still going down the really curved aesthetic. The back of the phone is curved, that sort of, you know, 2.5D curvature around the edge, but also the screen is curved. And like I said, I think the display, I know that's not for everyone, a curved screen, but I think factoring that in, this could be a thing that appeals to a lot of people at this price, because you're getting a curved 120 hertz OLED at £450, €530, which there aren't many phones that can hit that. There are 120 hertz phones for sure. There are a few 120 hertz OLEDs. They're usually flat screen though. I don't know that there's another. The Realme GT, is that curved, Chris? The display?
I was just looking at some of the Realme GT figures and facts because, it feels like that is a key rival to this on a 50, but it's not a curved screen, no.
Right, yeah. So if you like a curved screen, I think that will make this one really stand out, and it is pretty unique at the price point for offering that. I'm aware there's loads of people out there who hate curved screens, and so that will be a big detractor for them. But there are also curved screen fans, and you know, they just don't really exist in this high quality at this price. So,
well, the only one that's wrong. Sorry, you go, Lewis.
I was going to say the only other phone that stuck in my mind was the Motorola Edge, but even that's more expensive, just a little bit more expensive than the top SKU of the Honor 50, because I think that came in at about 550.
A point you mentioned last week, Dom, when you said you were going to be talking about it this week, was the fact that, you know, this is probably a latent design from the Huawei Honor, kind of when they were still part of and parcel of the same gig, because of the Nova 9, which launched last week, and the similarities therein. But I kind of was hoping, and maybe I can still hold out hope, that this new independent Honor could maybe come to market with a more distinct and unique design. Not that that phone looks bad by any means.
No.
But, you know, like when Nokia, the Nokia Lumia range was like its own thing that really nothing else looked, even like the non-fluorescent ones, even the white and the black phones still looked markedly different than anything else in the market. I would love to see something like that. And Honor, I feel, is one of the few brands that's poised to be able to deliver on that kind of thing.
I totally agree. So, I mean, just since you mentioned it, I have the Nova 9 here now as well.
Oh, great.
So if we want the direct...
Wow.
They
Look
are.
That.
I think the I same like chassis. The Nova's camera system more there. Just like, it looks cleaner to me. They're all black.
I think the colouring they've picked on the modules is slightly different. But yeah, otherwise the chassis is identical. Yeah. Though the actual camera tech, I know I mentioned last week, the camera tech is different. I haven't had the chance to test them out to see which I prefer, but certainly the main lenses, they're completely different main lenses and sensors. So they will have different results. I really agree with your point. I like this phone a lot. If there's a downside to it for me, is it feels a lot like a Huawei phone or an old Honor phone, which isn't a bad thing.
No.
But I equally feel I'm really curious to see what Honor does when it's making stuff from scratch and we're just not there yet. This is still Huawei hardware to some extent that is being released. And, you know, there's obviously a lot of other bits that are going in and now the final detailing is being done by Honor, the design choices and the software side, obviously. But we haven't seen a phone that Honor has built from scratch yet. And I don't know how long that's going to take. Probably, hopefully sometime next year, we'll see the first one that Honor can say, like, beginning to end, this is Honor, there's no Huawei. I'm really curious what those look like. The fact that they've kept releasing these Huawei ones makes sense because they want to put phones out and make money off them, obviously. But it does make me worry they're going to aim for continuity aesthetically rather than a clean break. And I'd like to see them do something different, not because this is bad, but because it's just be nice to see someone, like, as you said, they're in a great position to really just do a new design from the ground up and say, hey, what do we want phones to look like?
Yeah, I guess devil's advocate, they didn't really break step much in China. Like, I think there probably was a bit of a hold up, but probably not that much. And the fact they were able to bring out a new device under their own steam so soon.
Yeah.
So maybe like the fans there, because they do have a decent market share in China, if I'm not mistaken.
They have a very substantial, they're up, they say now, to 16%.
Yeah.
Right, I think of the Chinese market, which is enormous. That's a lot of devices.
So yeah, maybe that's what's stopping them from doing something as drastic as that.
Yes, it is a funny, you know, for us, it feels like Honor's back after 2 years of not releasing hardware. In China, they've been releasing hardware, not at the same rate, but they have been putting phones out for the last 2 years. So, you know, this sense of a comeback is in a way an outside of China view on what's going on. But really, there probably is a lot more consistency to the journey they've been taking within China. But even so, yeah, at some point we're going to see them build a phone right from the start themselves, and I'm really curious to see what they look like. I'm curious to see how well they perform, and really obviously the big one is camera side, because they've always benefited from Huawei throwing so much R&D at camera tech. Curious to see what Honor is capable of by itself, and I'm optimistic about that, but you know, curious. Wouldn't want to assume it will be impressive.
I liked the tagline in your written review, but I did wish you'd use "don't call it a comeback," because I feel like that would have worked.
Yeah, that would have worked too. What else have we talked about? Yeah, so design and display, I think I really like. Battery, I've said, is pretty solid. Charging, 66 watt wired. So pretty fast. Yeah. No wireless at all. And also no waterproofing. So those are the two big flagshipy things you're not getting, but that's fine. I think when the wired charging is that fast, it's okay. Yeah. Chipset is the Snapdragon 778G. That is the one I said came out a couple months ago and has been updated with a plus model as of this week. Funnily enough, Toddy, you mentioned the Xiaomi Mi 11, or is it just Xiaomi 11 now? Yeah, the Xiaomi 11 Lite. 11. But anyway, so there was the Xiaomi Mi 11 Lite 5G. Yeah.
Which I reviewed.
And then there's the Xiaomi 11 Lite 5G NE.
Which you've seen in the flesh.
Which I've seen. They are the exact same body, but the 5G NE version, the more recent one, uses the Snapdragon 778G.
Oh, does it?
Right. So it's the same chip as this. So in that sense, yes, there's a very clear through line between this phone and that. Mm. Also, similarly, this boasts 108 megapixel main camera. Which again, I think the Mi 11 Lite is also 108, but I might be misremembering. It's a solid main camera. I do suspect, having spoken about the Nova, I feel like the camera here is probably going to beat it. And actually, funny enough, just as I say that, I've spotted someone in the comments on YouTube saying exactly that, but the camera of the Nova 9 is better than the Honor 50. So very possible. I haven't tested the Nova 9 camera fully, but on paper, I think it will probably win, just based on sensor size and things like that. The 108 megapixel one here is good. It's great in good lighting, which of course is a really common refrain now at this mid-range cameras. Like, if you're in good lighting, this nails it. It looks fantastic. And with 108 megapixel, the detail is really phenomenal. So absolutely brilliant. I feel like it drops off pretty sharply as you get into dimmer light and low light, even just kind of like evening light. I can really see images come out washed out and there's a pretty sharp drop in detail, probably partly because there's no OIS here. So as soon as it has to do any sort of longer exposure, the stabilization is dropping out and you're just not going to get all the same detail being kept. So that's a little disappointing. Hoping some of that will be fixed in fine tuning. You know, it's worth noting, so we said, this is one of Honor's first phones, independent company. It's also among their first phones on Snapdragon chipsets because they used to work with Kirin. So they've got to get used to a whole new set of silicon. So I can believe there's room for, you know, software improvement on some of this stuff, but some things like no OIS, that's just, you know, there isn't the stabilization here. It's going to be limited by that no matter what. And the other lenses are very forgettable. 8 megapixel ultra wide, which is as good as you'd think a small 8 megapixel ultra wide thrown in a quad camera would be likely to be. 2 megapixel depth sensor for portrait mode, fine. And a 2 megapixel macro camera, which again, if you've ever used an Android quad camera phone that has a 2 megapixel macro in there, they are all that.
What a waste of components and materials. Yeah, no.
I know, it's very frustrating, especially when, you know, it's kind of funny because, say, in the wake of the iPhone 13, and a much more expensive phone than this, so maybe an unfair comparison, but obviously Apple there just throws in a main camera and an ultra-wide, and then a macro mode using the ultra-wide. And, you know, especially with this dual-ring setup, I would love this phone so much more if it was just two lenses, each with a big ring, and you had a big sensor main camera and a decent ultra-wide, and the ultra-wide could take macro shots too. And yeah, just do that. Like, it doesn't need four lenses. It's, you could do much better with two. And the money they put in putting those macro and depth sensor, if they put in a better ultra wide for that money, I would be happier at least.
Yeah.
But
I am curious to know, like, again, it's another part of like when the separation and where the separation occurred between Honor and Huawei and the development process of this phone. But yeah, just knowing how close or how good the camera tuning is, the kind of algorithm stuff, like whether that is all Honor post Huawei or
yeah,
it's
exactly.
got some latent Huawei tech in there, because that could make or break Honor as a brand if their cameras suddenly fall apart because the processing is so bad. Like companies exactly. like Sony, you know, they make the best, generally speaking, smartphone camera sensors there are, but they themselves really struggle to match, you know, the likes of Samsung and Apple when using those sensors with automated stuff. They're great if you know how to use the manual controls. And we'll probably get onto this. But yeah, like they struggle in that department. And Huawei, you know, was really good. They got so quickly did they become such a powerhouse in the camera department, mainly because of their tuning. And I just wonder how much of that carries across to Honor and this phone.
I think a lot of it they're probably having to do to some extent from the ground up, if only because, like I said, it's a move to new silicon as well.
Yeah,
Snapdragon away from Kirin.
Different ISP.
Yeah, exactly. It changes all the sensor hardware and the processing hardware that they're working with, as well as everything else. And obviously, there are manufacturers out there who will flip between MediaTek and Qualcomm chips for different handsets. And, you know, so clearly there is some ability to just port stuff across.
Yeah.
And at the core, all these chips are based on the same ARM, you know, plans anyway, but still there's just gonna be more complication there that they have to work on. One thing that's maybe a little bit revealing on that topic is Honor's made a big push on this phone that it's got this it's great for vlogging because it has a nice UI set up for filming from multiple lenses simultaneously and doing split screen or picture in picture using rear lenses and the front lens, and they've got a nice UI that lets you switch between those on the fly while recording and take still photos while you're doing that as well. None of which is brand new. You know, there are other phones that do this, but you know, they have a version of it that works pretty well and a UI that I'll admit is quite sort of friendly to navigate around, where you've got this, you know, column of the different view options and a shutter button there for stills. First thing I did when I got the Nova 9 was, is that in there? And it is, but it's not exactly the same. And that's interesting. So it is there. That UI is broadly the same. You've got the same set of options of switching cameras. But the layout of the camera app is different in terms of where they've positioned it. The name they've given it is different. And the Huawei one doesn't let you take stills while you're recording. Oh. So there's clearly, again, at some point in the software side of building the camera stuff here is where the line was. Huawei had built this vlogging software.
Yeah.
And then they're not on a split, and then Honor had to finish it by itself and made different choices to Huawei on how to finish it, I guess.
It's basically asking your mate to copy their homework and just change it a little bit.
Just
you
change
know?
Enough so no one can tell. Yeah,
they just grab the hard drive as they're walking out the door being like, I think this is ours.
So the camera is fine. It's just not amazing. And Honor is pushing the camera hard, but I think it's a shame because actually if I were them, I would push the display and the design, which to me feel like really clear winners in this space, at least for a certain taste. And the camera is, there are other phones with similar camera quality, which is to say a good main camera as long as the light's good and bad secondary cameras. And like that's this, most mid-range Android phones basically fit that description.
What's the wider user experience like now? Has it changed much from old Honor phones, or does it just feel like the old ones that had Google Play services on? Like, does
it feels very familiar? Similar. Okay. So there's still, it's Android 11, which is nice. I was a little worried it would be shipping Android 10 or something like that, but no, it is Android 11. No word on when they expect to upgrade to 12 or anything like that, but it's 11. It's Magic UI 4.2. So that is the name they used for their OS on the Huawei. It was, you know, EMUI on the Huaweis and Magic UI on the Honors, which was always, again, fundamentally the same Android skin, but with little tweaks to it. You know, in the same way you've got the links between Oxygen OS and Color OS on the Oppo and OnePlus side, or Realme UI in the same family there. This feels very familiar still. It's the same like white and blue aesthetic they've always had. For anyone who's used those, you'll know the look of that. That's, you know, the settings tiles and the notification tray and all of that kind of stuff. But they clearly are building in little things for themselves. So one of the nice things on here is they've got a new always on display stuff, and they've just added in some new always on display designs. And they've got some that sort of are abstract finishes that pull their colors from photos you take, if you want them to. So you can take a photo of something, they suggest an outfit you're wearing, but obviously it could be anything. It will pull out the three primary colors and create a custom always on display for you, which is just nice. It's a small thing. It's, you know, not groundbreaking by any means, but that's new. That's an Honor thing. And it's nice to see. And that is the thing they are touting, is that and the vlogging that they're like, here are the software things we've done. So it's clearly they're beginning to build it up. But yeah, you know, that's there and that's welcome. One more question just from the YouTube comments is, what about the 120 hertz? Did I notice any lag after opening an app? No, 120 hertz, really smooth, performed very well. I've been happy, and generally very smooth performance all around. It's a 778G, which is a mid-range chip, but definitely an upper mid-range chip. I really don't think there's any problem there unless you're, again, as we always say, unless you're playing really intense video games or a lot of like 4K video rendering or something like that. Otherwise, you're really not going to tell. I will say it's not, you wouldn't expect it at this price. It's not LTPO. So it's not got that dynamic refresh rate that drops down to 1 hertz or 10 hertz or anything like that. It's just 60 or 120. But yeah, no, it's impressive for what it is.
Sounds good. I'm just not sure I would go with it over the Realme GT, which is Snapdragon 888, cheaper, you know, and still decent camera.
You get a little more power with the GT for sure. I obviously haven't tested that camera. I would maybe trust Honor's camera to outperform the Realme a little bit, but I wouldn't be sure without actually doing side-by-side testing. But that feels like a fairly close competitor. It's a shame it still hasn't had really a proper launch everywhere, because it's such a strong phone, and at least in the UK it's annoying to try and buy, which feels like Realme shooting themselves in the foot, because it's such a great piece of hardware. But if you are in a country that where you can buy the GT, yeah, I would probably go for that. I would also say the obvious, you know, phone I really like this year around this price is the OnePlus Nord 2, and that is still an excellent choice. It is cheaper than this. It offers fairly similar performance and display stuff. It's a bit chunkier than this. It's not got the curved screen. So again, I think a lot of it's going to come down for me. It's how much that display appeals to you. Getting 120 hertz curved OLED, that's the USP here. And if you're like, I want that, but I can't afford a true, you know, flagship, then this is the phone to get. And there's no major compromise you're making anywhere else. There's no feature I'd pick out and be like, oh, well, it's awful at that. It's just, it's a bit, you know, middling camera, middling performance, that kind of thing. So it's not going to excel elsewhere.
What did you say the price was for the UK, sorry?
For the UK, it starts at 450. Europe, it's 529, 530.
That's like, it's a bit of a reach, but the price drop on the Galaxy S21, the base model, is within £100. I mean, that's still maybe a bit too much for a reach for most people if they're looking around that price point, but that I find is an interesting potential upgrade as well, just because of the software support and stuff you get through that.
Yeah, as soon as you factor in price drops on flagships, it becomes a lot more complicated to make that call, obviously. And the software point is a good one, because as far as I can find out, Honor haven't made any promises about upgrades or anything like that. How many Android versions you're going to get, how many years of security patches. They're still figuring this stuff out, I guess. So I think it's understandable they're not willing to put their money where their mouth is yet. But I think that is a good reason to have a little bit of pause before committing to this, because other brands are beginning to get better about making promises in that respect. And
that was the big disappointment for the Moto Edge 20 range as well, which I think on the lower end, kind of same territory pricing wise. But yeah, again, we like initially they were like just one, and then like, okay, no two.
Yeah.
OS upgrades. But yeah, still, even that was a bit.
in a way, I'd rather have silence than them promising one.
Yeah.
At least with silence, I can hope.
It's dead on arrival, you know? Otherwise, pretty much, you know.
One is the minimum, surely.
Yeah. Especially for a budget phone, maybe they say one and I say, all right, fine. But
like
£400
up. Like, what are you doing?
Not good enough. Anyway, so that is the Honor 50. It is available to pre-order right now. In the UK, it ships from November 12th. I think that will vary a little bit across Europe and the Asian markets where it's out, but it's broadly mid-November-ish. You'll be able to actually get one. I honestly really like this. It's made me more excited for the Honor Magic 3, which is the flagship series. They also have launched in China and promise is shipping globally at some point soon. So we don't know when that will be, but this is clear sign that Honor is, you know, here and they're making good phones. We just have to see how much of that is still riding on the coattails of Huawei and how much of that they can carry through by themselves as we go over the next couple of years. Right, let's move on to the Sony Xperia Pro-I, which is such an odd phone.
I love it. I love weird Sony stuff.
I say that with a lot of affection. You know, I like that this is a really weird phone. So in case you missed it, this was a phone that Sony announced just this week. And it is, I believe the Sony line, because it's certainly what I've seen in a lot of the coverage, is that this is camera first, phone second. And basically they've said they've built a camera that can match a lot of their standalone compact cameras, but they've put it in a phone body and it will work as a phone. In a way, that's a funny way of describing what is actually pretty much an Xperia 1 Mark III with an upgraded main camera, which is fundamentally what they've done in here. But I think that's a pretty good thing. I mean, I haven't used the 1 Mark III, but I'm actually on the 5 Mark III at the moment, and I like it a lot. And I'm very intrigued by this camera. So the main lens is the big thing here, which is they've used a 1-inch sensor. They're not the first to do that. Recently, there was the Sharp Aquos R6, which only launched in Japan, but that was the first recent sort of smartphone with a 1-inch sensor. You'd have to go years back to find another one. This is a 1-inch sensor, and it's the same sensor they use in the RX100 Mark 7 point-and-shoot camera.
A hugely popular vlogging camera, the RX100 series, is like their go-to. So it's a solid sensor, and I think in the marketing material for this phone, you can see the overlap beyond... It was interesting, like, even that initial picture, if it's like a camera first. I really loved the Samsung Galaxy camera range, which were, they took a SIM card, but they were billed as cameras, and they looked like combat cameras with like a fixed motorized zoom lens like system built in the back. And I love the idea of being able to share direct from a camera and knowing that you were going to get superior quality than phone cameras were just potatoes. So yeah, this makes a lot of sense from that perspective, whether there's a market for it now, because the phone cameras have gotten as good as they've gotten, is maybe the harder question to ask. And it's an interesting pivot from the Xperia Pro from last year, which is really shown off as a broadcasting tool more than anything else. You could plug it into your Sony camera and use the SIM and the connectivity to kind of augment your already very good camera with cellular connectivity. This is now kind of doing the reverse. Which is a weird, considering that's where they were taking it with the Pro last year, I thought.
Yeah, I mean, what's interesting is that Pro, we often talk about that the Pro name on a product being a bit misleading. And last year's Xperia Pro was that rare case where we were like, no, genuinely, this is a Pro product. This is built for professionals. It's an industry device.
It's a tool.
We weren't even sure it would appear in sort of consumer stores, because why would it? This is a half step back from that, right? Because... You could definitely see this having appeal for people doing some sort of professional video work where they want a compact phone size device to do that with. But it is clearly meant to more appeal to vloggers and people who kind of want a phone that will replace their camera or something like that, or at least something that they can use it on the go and get camera quality results out of it without having to carry a camera. But as you say, the challenge there is, I think a lot of people feel that phones are already mostly there, not all the way, but pretty close. It's also in a funny spot in terms of pricing, because it's £1,600, $1,800, which puts it up with like the Z Fold. But it also means it's a big price jump, but it's a few hundred more than the Xperia 1 Mark III, where, as I said, functionally the only difference is that one lens.
Yeah.
So they are asking people to essentially pay a 400 premium for that one lens, which, again, if you're not using it for a professional use, I can't see why you would ever justify that. Right.
It feels like a very strange middle ground between those two devices.
Yeah.
In terms of the price and the difference in camera and specs. Because, you know, even just you watch like the TV adverts for the new iPhone range, and it's all about, you know, you can use this to film a flipping movie on. Like, people are, you know, people will be convinced by that. So you've really got to know about these like very tiny camera spec details, like the fact that it's using a 1-inch sensor and the fact that the aperture is adjustable and all these kind of little details, in which case are you not just getting the, you know, the Pro?
Yeah.
And otherwise you're just thinking, well, that phone's too expensive.
I mean, they're definitely, it's clearly part of their general strategy. It's worth saying Sony over the last few years has sold very, very, very small numbers of mobile phones. I'm confident they must be losing money on them as a bit of their business, but they must see some other benefit to keeping it going because the scale they're operating at is small. I think, Toddy, I remember when LG shut its mobile business, I think you pointed out that Sony was selling fewer phones than LG was at the time when LG decided it was no longer profitable to keep going.
Incorrect. I haven't checked my figures since that conversation, but at the time, I think it was like less than 1% of the global smartphone market was Sony.
Yeah.
Which is not too surprising. So
they're not selling in bulk. And they clearly made the decision to sort of accept that and go after niches. And this is clearly them just trying to basically, it feels like it's them polarizing around that niche and just trying to figure out like, triangulate it, like what's the right way to get this niche of camera people and convince camera people that when they buy their phone they should buy a Sony phone. And it's been interesting using the 5 Mark III because it's the first Sony I've used in a couple of years, but I know this is the generation where they started changing around their camera app stuff, and so when you use the camera app, the UI feels like a camera. It doesn't feel like a phone camera. Everything about it feels like I'm using a camera. Even like the little green boxes popping up to show where the autofocus is catching stuff. And, you know, if you can, you know, half hold down the shutter button and then to get the autofocus and then push in, they're fully trying to replicate the camera experience and just go after that crowd. And this is definitely a continuation of that, right? They're, for better or worse, the niche they're chasing is people who are already buying Sony cameras.
It doesn't make sense to me.
But it's not many people.
Last year's Pro makes a lot more sense, trying to bill it as a tool to augment their good cameras that everyone knows they make good cameras, to then have a phone that is trying to encroach on that market segment and not really do anything else beyond what the Pro did before, except with updated hardware.
Yeah.
I'd struggle way more with this than last year's offering in terms of the Pros. Mm. And also the camera UI thing I find quite funny, just because even though Sony is generally regarded as having pretty decent camera UIs, famously, they're not usually very good or elegant UIs versus what smartphones can do because of the touchscreen aspect. Mm. Even though like Canons and Nikon cameras now have a touchscreen, like, yeah, Canon's like interface, there are third party people who develop their own ROMs effectively to change that UI because it's typically so disliked.
Totally.
So then bring that onto your phone and be like, look, it's professional because it's maybe worse and less user, like less intuitive. Absolutely. Is also weird to me.
When I flag that it has that, you know, that aesthetic, I'm not particularly saying that in a complimentary way. No,
it's just a fact.
It's interesting that they've done that. Yeah. I don't really like it very much. It's a very clunky camera app, and the way they split out photo and video options is borderline mad. It's very... very unfriendly to the user.
Yeah.
yeah, I was completely bemused when I first opened the camera app and thought there must have been some mistake. And I was like, no, this is the pro app. I want the normal app for normal people.
Which they did have. And now it's the basic setting in the pro app, which lets you shoot video unless you want 4K or special video. And then you have to go to the separate video app.
And it means the whole time you're trying to use your camera app, there's a little bit of green text in one corner just saying basic.
Yeah.
I'm you're basic.
Lewis's squint of discomfort at this, like, as like the principal iPhone user among us here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's an odd experience.
Yeah. Not enjoying that.
Obviously, in a way, this new phone, the Pro-I, is so hard to talk about because we just have to test one, because the whole appeal will come down to, well, how good is that main lens? And if it is genuinely the best main camera in any phone right now, then cool, the pitch works. Like, some people will pay for that, no doubt. But if it's just good and like as good as the iPhone or the Pixel, then I don't know, it's a non-starter, right?
Yeah, I think it has to be good in every area as well. It can't just be good in good light, you know, in bright light. It has to be good for night mode. It has to be good on all these other things if you're going to pay that price for it.
And that's all the algorithmic stuff that, as Toddy said, I wouldn't really associate as Sony's strength. Their hardware is phenomenal.
Yeah,
you know, there's a reason their sensors are the ones everyone uses in their phones for the most part, or them and Samsung basically. But yeah, the algorithmic side has never felt like it's their A game. Their software lets their hardware down, and so I don't see this and immediately feel like, oh yeah, this is going to be the best.
I guess a good test, just because Sony phones are really good at, is the autofocus tech that they pulled from their cameras. They got like eye autofocus and it can do pets, and it is genuinely amazing watching it work because it is so good at holding focus on a subject. Trying that or applying that to this, I know it's not new for Sony to use, but on a phone, translating that RX 100 Mark 7 sensor into a phone and then having that eye focus tech, if that translates well, that's like a nice upgrade, because even on the standard triple 12 megs that you get on the Xperia 1 and 5 Mark 3, that's really good. So having it on this even better sensor, assuming it is better, is great. Like, if you already like that from your Sony phones, which it was good on last year's phones as well, then, you know, this does seem like the obvious choice if you can afford it.
It just feels like a lot of the people they're targeting at this app probably already have a decent camera, like an RX or even an Alpha or something. Like, all the people I can think that I know that this would appeal to, and I'd be like, oh hey, did you know Sony's released this new phone? They'd be like, yeah, but I've already got a camera. And they and they are the kind of people that are happy to carry or around that camera as well as their phone, because they know the difference between the two and they want that difference. So I don't know,
or the proposition hasn't changed
then, maybe.
The proposition alternatively hasn't changed enough from their previous phones. So like the you know, last year and even the year before, but last year especially, like if they spent £1,000 on a one Mark II, this ain't going to be the camera system that
totally
I'm
a little surprised to see the other lenses stay basically unchanged from the one Mark III, which, you know, those are good lenses, like, so I get it on one level, but equally, to really sell this upgrade, I know they've gone all in on this main lens and the 1-inch sensor, and that is very impressive, but it would help if they could also say, and we've upgraded the ultrawide and the periscope is way better. And if you could pitch that every single camera lens, at least the rear ones, were improved from their existing flagship, it would be a much easier sell. To really just be, it's only the main lens. Everything else is the same as what you can already buy in another device.
I mean, 1-inch brings it into the same kind of conversation as some small cameras or some regular cameras. Photographers typically say, like, it's not the body, it's the lenses that make the pictures really, like, or the video really worth it. I could see Sony, and they have sort of done this in the past with these connected lenses that they made. You know, if they just served up a version of the Xperia 1 Mark III or this that took really nice quality Sony lenses that they already made, that would be cool. That could have value. But at the same time, smartphone lens accessories kind of a sort of a dirty word or a dirty kind of concept. Like they're usually disregarded as just cheap rubbish add-ons, with the exception of maybe Moment. Like they're the only brand that's managed to stick around with those as like a worthwhile high-end lens brand for smartphones. That would make a more meaningful upgrade here than I think what they've done with just putting the bigger sensor on there, as much of an achievement as that is. But yeah, I think the reality of it is that they couldn't peddle the lens system, even if that is actually a better upgrade for people than what they've done.
Well, it's a bit of both, isn't it? Because I think you're right that in the camera space, in a way, it's the lens that matters. But in the phone space right now, the sensors have been the bottleneck for the last year or two. And, you know, we are seeing bigger sensors has been one of the biggest spaces manufacturers have found room to improve on. So I guess on one level, you could almost see this kind of makes sense for Sony, because they might just be saying, look, we know everyone's about to do 1-inch sensors, but if we can get in there first, and Sharp beat them to it ever so slightly, but it is a Japan exclusive, so I don't know how much of an impact, but globally, this is the first 1-inch sensor in a smartphone. And it's only going to be a year or two before Samsung has one ready to go. And suddenly they're in all the Xiaomi and Samsung flagships. But right now, Sony gets to be the people who do that. And there's at least a PR win there for them, even if no one buys the bloody thing.
Yeah, but, it was the Panasonic A1. The Panasonic CM1 was CM1, in 2014, had a 1-inch sensor as well.
Yeah.
And Leica branding, actually, kind of.
Oh, did it? I didn't realize I had the Leica branding.
Yeah, so history repeats itself.
I find it kind of funny that I've been so down on this in a way as we've been talking about it, because like I said, I've been trying out the 5 Mark III and I have been really enjoying the 5 Mark III. I like
They're
it
great
a lot.
Phones.
And I've been feeling a bit like, oh, it's just a shame no one buys these things. So I'm really enjoying this phone. And then they release a new one and I'm like, oh, what a stupid phone. No one should buy that. But it's like, it probably is a really nice phone.
But if
it's
you buy
just,
it will do you well. It's really
good. I just look at it as a piece of hardware. I bet this Pro-I is phenomenal, but in terms of the pricing, in terms of the business strategy, I struggle to understand the approach Sony is taking for the moment, which is a shame. I feel like they're building phones that I enjoy and that not that many people do, which is concerning in part because that's what all the tech journalists used to say about LG. And look what happened there. Everyone loved LG phones. People was like, such a shame no one buys these because we love them. And yeah, there's only so long you can live on the goodwill of tech journalists.
And they've gone on a really long time, I think, on that so far. It's kind of crazy, I think. Although, you know, this approach of camera first, phone sort of second, maybe we're in the kind of, we're going to get a new Xperia Play. Like a PSP portable, 5G, PS5. Maybe that's next. That's my hope.
About to say the opposite, that this feels to me like it's them recognizing that the PlayStation tie-ins did not work.
They've given up on that. It was
so
frustrating.
Now they're looking around the rest of their business for like which business units can they tie their phone brand to. And for a while they were like, PlayStation, because everyone on the bloody planet owns a PlayStation. And it just didn't work. You know, it was a complete non-starter. And so it does feel like now they're realizing, right, well, probably should have been cameras all along. So we'll tie it to our camera ecosystem. But it is still a difficult pitch. I feel like if nothing else, they just need to do a better job of branding the stuff that way so that you really, they sell the brand connection to the fact that they're a leading camera company. Mm. And I just never feel like that really comes across in the way I see Sony phones presented.
All the hate we give Sony's phone names and pretty much everyone's phone names nowadays versus like the headphones and stuff.
I was literally just about to say this.
This is actually quite a good branding name.
I honestly feel like,
I don't think. Maybe one.
I feel like they should go like all in on the phone names and actually put the mark in the name like they do with a lot of the cameras and really just acknowledge, we're naming them after the cameras because again, it cements that connection. Like this is one of the best consumer camera companies in the world. So even if they're not one of the best phone camera companies in the world, they should be selling the idea that they are.
Yes.
And that should be a very easy sales pitch.
They need to believe it.
Yeah.
It's like they've only gone halfway there. Like if you're going to do it, just do it. And then at least we can accept what you've chosen to do. It feels a little bit one foot in the boat.
Anyway, sorry, Sony, we've been bad mouthing you for 20 minutes. But actually I like the look of the Pro-I. I'm really keen for one of us to get into a review and I want to see what this camera is capable of. And I'm really excited to see what it can do. we're just skeptical that anyone's going to buy one, but probably very good hardware. On that note, let's talk Pixels, a hardware line famously excellent and unsold, at least in mass quantities. Is the Pixel 6 the generation that's going to change that? Google certainly hopes so. They're pushing this as the year Pixel goes mainstream and mass market. Sixth time's the charm, I guess. Toddy and Chris, you've been playing around with the 6 Pro and the 6 respectively. Do these feel like mainstream devices now that could take off and be, you know, iPhone killers, or is this still a tech nerd niche?
I don't know about iPhone killer, but I have seen a lot more interest and hype around these than previously.
Mm-hmm.
Like Pixel 5 launched and it was like, yeah, good phone, another good Pixel phone if you want a cheap phone. But I never had people asking me about the phones, you know, in the past very much, you know, whereas over the last couple of weeks, I've had a lot of people asking me like, is it good? What do I'm going to order one. Blow it, like all that kind of stuff. It feels like it's reaching people. You know, Google's whatever they've done. I don't know if they've stepped up with marketing and stuff.
They've spent a lot more on marketing.
Yeah,
it's worked then, because a lot of people are interested and excited about this phone.
I have to wonder how much of that comes down to design, because love it or hate it, and I'm personally maybe not quite hate, but I'm definitely on the, you know, I'm one of the Debbie Downers on the look of these phones. It's eye-catching and it's memorable and it's different. And if there's been a fault to the previous Pixel designs, which I've generally liked, but they've been very nondescript.
Yeah.
And they've been very like, here's a phone. It looks like a phone. You'll probably buy it in black. these are really weird looking devices, and people are going to talk about that, and people are going to see them and go, whoa, what's that phone? And even if not everyone likes it, at least that is going to help together with that marketing spend to increase awareness a lot, I guess.
Yeah. You feel very more Google, even though, you know, we've been quite used to the Pixel range for, you know, however many years now. If you look at some of the, you know, the Nest speakers and the way they come in those pastel, you know, the different colors and slightly unusual shapes and stuff, this feels more aligned with that.
Yeah.
It is quite divisive though, you know, still. In the same way, I think some of those Nest speakers, some people will look at those colors and think they're horrible, but you can always get them in the gray, so it doesn't matter too much. I've always been a fan of the Pixel phones, and but they have been a bit plain.
This is anything up, I think, but plain, especially this the sort of Sunny, which is a sorter, sorry, with an A, with the gold frame and stuff. This is probably the most ostentatious Pixel I've ever seen. Like, they usually try and go for a pretty understated look. This ain't that. It's huge. The Pro is huge. It is around the same kind of vibe as an S21 Ultra, which is, I think, even though it's got a slightly smaller screen, because it's slightly wider. It's the heaviest Pixel yet. It feels really nicely made, like, and it looks precise and high end, with the exception of, I think with the Pro, they messed up the proportions. The regular model has a much nicer proportion between the camera bar and the top of the phone. And there's also this plastic cap, which I don't know if you can tell, but the metal frame ends, and then there's a big kind of plastic cap in the middle, which shouldn't be there.
Antenna and connectivity and stuff like that, right?
Yeah, but then there's antenna breaks in the frame elsewhere, which I'm fine with. So I don't know why they need such a big plastic cap unless they are really struggling with connectivity.
That's weird.
HTC, a lot of the people who worked at HTC on phones now work at Google making the phones. They cracked making metal-bodied phones, literally full metal back phones with decent reception. So this doesn't make sense to me. That's the one thing that undermines this. You know, this is also the most expensive Pixel yet.
Yeah.
From a hardware and design standpoint, it looks great. It feels lovely. It's too big for me, and it's pretty heavy. That really bugged me. Also, because it doesn't quite color match the color that it's next to, so it really sticks out.
No, I remember that sticking out when I saw the phone in the office. It immediately was like, oh, that weird line on the top.
Rounded, you see it from the front of the phone too.
Right. Yeah.
So yeah, it's not hidden.
I wonder if it's not so bad on the black, on the other colors, because I didn't notice that on this at all, because it's black, it's very hidden.
Right.
But yes, it's one of the reasons I've always liked the Pixel phones is because they're small, and I quite like small phones, and the screens were big enough for me. So yeah, the fact that even this regular Pixel 6 is huge, over 200 grams.
Yeah, it's a beast.
9 millimeters, yeah. not including the camera bar.
Yeah.
And the camera bar is a good couple of mil thick. Like,
yeah. I find it funny because you could make
thick.
Yeah, it's thick. They're enormous. Yeah,
it's thick with a C.
It is wow. Proper chunk.
You could make a good, decent argument that this is part of that same push to make these mainstream devices, because obviously we've seen with the iPhone mini that doing the small phone actually doesn't sell, at least not on the same scale, and it wasn't enough for Apple to bother sticking with it. So I could see maybe Google recognizing that, oh, maybe making small phones wasn't actually a winning strategy. But still, the Pixel 6 is comfortably bigger than an iPhone 13, and I don't know why they couldn't have kept the base model at roughly that Galaxy S21, iPhone 13 sort of size. It isn't a small phone, but it's, you know, a bit more user-friendly.
Yeah,
so you can just that's get crazy. I can't get over that.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Massive.
I mean, you do kind of get used to it. Like,
yeah.
You know, like anytime you switch on a phone, you switch to a different phone and it's bigger or smaller or thicker or whatever, you do just get used to it. But I wouldn't, you know, I would understand if it put people off buying it.
I also find it funny because looking at the line together, it's this slightly weird, it puts the two together in an odd space because the Pro is bigger, but it's not actually that much bigger. They're almost the same size.
Yeah,
it's a little taller, but that's about it. And obviously heavier. But, you know, it's certainly the size isn't a big jump between them, but it is a bit of a jump between them. And to me, it just makes it feel a bit messy, where I like it when either they're the same size and it's just specs are different in one, yeah. Or there's a really clear, like the Pro to the Pro Max in the iPhone line, where you're like, yeah, this one's a bigger phone. And, yeah. You know, that's what it is. It feels like that's gotten a bit messy this time.
Yeah. They used to have, you know, a very clear jump when they had the XL models.
Like, yeah.
They were always like, if you want the big one, there's the XL. And if you want the regular one, it's a lot smaller.
Anyway, I think we should probably talk about the two things that we couldn't talk about last week because we were hands tied by embargo limitations. First up is Tensor, the chip inside all of this. So we spoke a little bit last time about you guys' experience using the phone day to day, and you both basically said it felt smooth and fluid and normal and all of that. So I guess my question is, a week on, is that still the case? Do you still feel like this feels like a flagship phone in terms of performance? B, how do these things benchmark? Because we are allowed to talk about our benchmarking experience now.
I don't think there's a phone, based on the kind of the cleanliness of Android 12 and kind of the improvements to the visual language used with Material U, I don't think there's a phone that feels as cohesive maybe as the Pixel 6 range does right now. Like, it does feel really nice jumping between the hardware and software. Real world performance stuff, like apps take a second to load, like not even a second across the board, whether you're using like challenging stuff like the camera, obviously games, like if you've got download game data from line, that's a different story, but the app itself will load like that. So it is, yeah, lightning fast in everything I've done so far, jumping between apps, split screen multitasking, it's great. Tensor's interesting. I think it is perfectly well equipped to be offer a flagship phone experience right now. It's paired with 12 gigs of RAM on the Pro, 8 gigabytes on the regular 6. The benchmark apps though paint a very different story. They basically show it off like an old chip from maybe last year in a high-end phone. Like the scores I was getting were either a decent mid-range Xiaomi from right now, like one of the ones that kind of defies its price tag. I forget what the model is because there's so many confusing model names, but like something along the lines of the Snapdragon 870. Or yeah, last year's Exynos 990, excuse me, in the yep. S20 Ultra. It was getting around the same sort of scores for CPU. In real world gaming, I mentioned last week, I was getting unbreakable basically frame rates, the 60 FPS in games that support 60, 120 FPS in games that support 120. So there's nothing obviously like problematic about the hardware in terms of real world performance. It just doesn't score very well because I think the chip architecture with that extra TPU and how they've kind of built the chip is different to your standard Snapdragon processor, and therefore the benchmarks that are just like ragging on the CPU isn't maybe as beefy, but then there's other stuff going on the chip that ensures that you still get a really fast, smooth, fluid user experience. That's my take on Tensor.
I would agree. If you care about benchmarks, then yeah, your Geekbench 5 score is much lower than anything around this price or more, but it performs fine in GFX Bench, which is the graphics one, so no real issues. And yeah, in since I've had the phone, I've not noticed anything. I've shot 4K at 60 frames per second video. It obviously drops the resolution down while you're doing some editing and stuff, but it pops back up to full resolution pretty quick after that. And yeah, opening apps, gaming, whatever, it's all fine.
So basically, it performs well, but there's a real risk that come September 2022, Google is going to be embarrassed on stage by Apple in a line graph about relative performance the other Silicon Valley company's in-house chip versus the A16 Bionic.
Yeah, cool. Because Apple's managed to do both, right? They've like made it their own chip, purpose make it for the other things they want their phone to do, but also they have aced all the benchmarks and it's like top of the line. Yep. Whereas Tensor isn't that. Tensor is just like, Google wanted to do this stuff with its new phone. They built a chip for that. It just doesn't necessarily then adhere to the industry standards and expectations. The whole thing about Tensor, they talked about it at launch, was it's built not just for where AI and machine learning is now, it's built for the future of that, or where it's going. That's what they were promising. So I'm hoping what that means is that Tensor will stand this phone in better stead longer term than a Snapdragon phone from right now sorts of tasks. That's really what I'm hoping. So it's really hard to see where it's going, but presumably based on the confidence of their marketing and their presentation, Tensor is the better option if you're going to do a lot of those things on your phone. So stuff like computational photography, if this is better than that, then a Snapdragon that's available right now, then cool, this is the best bet.
It's also worth saying on that note, having spoken about benchmarks, we run benchmarks that push the CPU and the GPU, basically.
Yeah.
We don't currently run any machine learning benchmarks. And it's something we've spoken about, and that may be something that changes and we start benchmarking around machine learning on chips, but we don't currently do it. And so that's one of the things I'd be interested to see is how this benchmarks from a machine learning perspective, because there are benchmarks out there focused on that, and how it compares to the top Snapdragons once you put it in that context, because that is where Google's more bullish about its performance potential. The other thing to flag is that we're obviously on the cusp of new Snapdragon and MediaTek flagship announcements, and they're both going to be based on ARM V9, which means, the Tensor has this unusual dual Cortex X1 chip configuration. We're about to get new chips using the Cortex X2 and the next gen of all these bits of ARM tech that underlie all this stuff. So there is an interesting question to see how much of a jump that generational leap is, and whether we're suddenly going to see that benchmark gap grow drastically wider, which again doesn't necessarily matter all that much, but we'll see. I think, for me, the big question is the machine learning gap on benchmarking is, does it really, how does it compare on that front? Because that's something that it's very hard for us to test in day-to-day use. Like, oh, how fast was the AI? I don't know. It's doing stuff in the background. The point is you've got no idea.
I guess one of the things is that these phones are not really aimed at people that care about benchmarks. It's more about...
Yeah.
It lets you do X, Y, and Z, and it brings to life our features and does stuff for you that's useful. And some of that does seem to show when you use things like Magic Eraser, which is the feature that's removes things from photos that you don't want there anymore. Like, it's a bit hit or miss that at the moment. Like, you can even remove telegraph poles and wires, and it would figure out what you might want to remove in the photo by itself, and then it will literally do it in like click of a fingers. But the results are a little bit hit or miss depending on the situation you've taken a photo of.
So let's talk about that. I think just because we yeah, so there are two things to really cover that we couldn't last week, and one was Tensor, and the flip side is, as you've been saying, what Tensor does, which is, you know, I think the main thing everyone cares about is, yeah, the photo side, yeah. How it drives the computational photography, both cool things like Magic Eraser and some of the other AI modes they've got, but also just the cameras in general.
Yeah, you can.
Oh,
just,
we're getting a live demonstration if you're watching the video.
Get rid of that cat.
Gone.
Oh, cat. Gone. It's not bad. A slightly odd dark spot where it used to be.
Yeah. It's one of those things where if you know what's being taken out, you can see sort of an outline of where it was. Maybe if you didn't know what was there before, it would be a bit harder.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've got to admit, from my perspective, Magic Eraser does look like the feature that wasn't quite fully baked, and maybe they should have saved for next year or for a Pixel feature drop in 6 months.
Drop it with a beta tag, you know.
At the same time, for this to be on a phone, and yes, other phones have done this, this is probably the best iteration of this kind of tech running on a phone that I've seen that isn't using cloud systems for backup.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's good. Yes, it's not perfect, but it's good. And if you are likely to like see the appeal of that feature, this is probably the best phone to get for a feature like that.
I guess my struggle with this is that when I, at least the samples I've seen a lot of, and to be fair, I haven't been reviewing the phone, you two have, so your takes may be worth more than mine. When it comes to a camera feature, good but not good enough isn't good enough. Like if it's good, but you can still see that it's bad, but bits of it are wrong, then it's like, well, cool, I'm not using that photo. A photo's just got to reach a certain quality level for me to be like, great, I'm sharing that, or I'm saving it, or I'm getting it printed somewhere or whatever. And if it's like, oh, cool, it does this amazing high-tech thing. I mean, the results are garbage. You don't want to show anyone, but it's so cool that it does it. I'm like, right, well, that's fine. It's cool that it does it, but that doesn't help me when I'm taking photos. I'm still not going to use the result.
I guess.
And I worry this isn't, I'm not saying this is garbage. It is impressive, but it's just not quite at the threshold for me yet where I've seen any results that I'd say, yeah, I would share that. I would be proud of that resulting photo.
Yeah. Right now, like having an ultra wide or whatever, it's about knowing when it's best used. The golden version, like the perfect version of this, is one where it doesn't matter what scenario you're shooting in, it will just fix the photo how you want it to be fixed. They're definitely not there yet, but it does have a time and a place in certain shooting situations. You're like, oh yeah, this is nice. Like even just taking, I took a power line out of a shot of a building because it was against the blue sky, so it was a nice harsh contrast, and so it totally understood
easy enough
the assignment and got it, and that's fine. But yeah, so yeah, I think right now it's a case of it's good if you know when it's best used. Down the line, the expectation will be it's got to be perfect without fail, or it's rubbish. Like,
yeah. I think that's part of it. It's coming from Google. The expectations are high if they're going to tout an AI camera feature, and when it comes around, it's like, oh, it's fine. Yeah. It's like I expect fine when most of the other Android brands drop an AI camera feature, and I go, oh, that's kind of cool. It doesn't work that well. I'll never use it. Move on. With Google, you expect it. It's like Apple. You expect it to just work. If they're going to announce that feature, it better just work.
Yeah.
And when it doesn't, I go like, ah, you should have saved that a year. You can afford to wait a year on that.
Cinematic mode.
Yes, exactly. Cinematic mode. What about cameras in general, though? Aside from the AI trickery, though, obviously there's AI trickery in all of it. But, you know, just we've got new lenses. We've got new sensors. Obviously, two on the Pixel 6 and three on the 6 Pro because we get the telephoto there. How do you guys feel about these? Are these, I mean, whenever a Pixel releases, fundamentally the question is this now the best smartphone camera? Or at the very least, is it now the best Android smartphone camera? Fair to say competition has heated up a lot in that regard. How does this fall? Is this the best, or is this just another very good one?
Chris, you want to go first?
I mean, I haven't tested, you know, obviously because we share all of the phone reviews around, I haven't tested every phone, but I would say this is likely the best phone for its price category because it just squeezes in under 600, which makes it mid-range for us. So it's probably the best camera phone you can get under £600. It's just like it's one of those things where it's basically flawless. Like, you know, either you're going to use the main camera most of the time, and it the hardware plus Google's, you know, clever camera app and all of the stuff it does in the background, it basically just means it's point and shoot. You can get it out in almost any situation and you'll get very good results, which you can't say for a lot of phone cameras. The ultra wide is good. You know, compare it to phones like the OnePlus 9, which is actually slightly more expensive on RRP. And there was a whole bunch of different problems we had with that. You know, it's particularly between the cameras, you know, with the colors being very different. None of that here. So yeah, in terms of the rear cameras, I think I would say they're the best in the mid-range. The front camera's pretty decent, like very good quality. It's just not particularly wide angle if you want to take shots of more than just yourself. I don't particularly care for a telephoto, so the Pro doesn't tempt me in that way.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, so that makes a lot of sense to me. I think the Pixel 6, it's a sweet spot where it is cheaper than we thought it would be. And yeah, I can't think of a phone around that price that I would take over it for camera based on what I've seen. Toddy, you reviewed the S21 Ultra. You've reviewed the iPhone 13, though not one of the Pro models.
Yeah.
Does the Pixel 6 Pro hold its own in that like really premium flagship space where the prices start to become, in a way, price becomes less of a factor because you're already dropping a grand? So
yeah,
people care about just getting the best one.
In a weird way, and this is more for like the verdict, if you will, but like the pricing actually I find is a little weird, like problematic, because, and camera being like the main deciding factor for a lot of those super high-end phones, this is cheaper than the Oppo Find X3, the iPhone 13 Pro Max, the S21 Ultra. I'd say the camera is better. The main and the ultra wide that both phones share, there's a really excellent color consistency, which is always the first thing I look for in that situation. The big upgrade that this, and also the iPhones, like I reviewed the standard iPhone 13 and I commented on it in that as well, is dynamic range is like an unspoken thing. Like there's all these fun features like cinematic mode and magic eraser, but dynamic range is getting better and better. And this year I've seen what I think is a huge leap forward. That was the biggest inconsistency between the S21 Ultra and the Pixel 6 Pro, was that the dynamic range, especially in the darker areas, there was so much more color and detail that you just lost on the Samsung that the Pixel was able to hold on to. And you just got a more, just, it was visually impressive. Some of the shots I was taking, I was like, wow. Like I don't always say wow when I do phone camera tests, but there was a few shots I was like, damn, like that's handling light so incredibly well. That actually does suffer a little bit with the telephoto. The zoom is insane. The hybrid zoom, if you will, the 20x super zoom, the level of detail it can hold on to in well-lit environments is really impressive. That is probably the best hybrid zoom I've seen on any phone ever. And the 4x is great too, the detail versus the like 7x on the standard Pixel 6 with super zoom. There's no contest that the optical zoom is fantastic. It doesn't have the same color consistency and accuracy or the same dynamic range as the ultra wide and the main, but it's still very, very good. Like I think it's probably the best. I think Samsung might have nailed their consistency across sensors better than Google has, but that is fixable via software. Like that is, yes, that is a minor problem. If that's all I'm really picking out, is that it's a little less vibrant on the telephoto than it is on the other sensors. Beyond that, yeah, stability is great. Low light, the main and the ultra wide are pretty solid. I wouldn't worry about using the telephoto so much. It does kind of suffer pretty roughly at greater distances, even with that dynamic range as well. But yeah, it's a heck of a camera on this phone. The telephoto is a nice extra. The kind of pain point I'm finding problematic is the fact that this phone is like almost, by pricing it under that £1,000 threshold that the main rivals that this is going to be compared against are, from a perception standpoint, this doesn't seem as fancy or as premium. I feel like there might be a psychological aspect to it that some people might not kind of, like they might not be able to see past, like, oh, why is this cheaper? Like it can't be as good.
It's like I said, when you're at that level, price stops mattering. The people buying the $1,000 phones aren't considering price as one of the main factors they're thinking about at that point, if they can afford that much. The Pixel 6 has to drive value because it's going for a competitive price point. Whereas this one, yeah, it, becomes weirdly positioned. I think I kind of agree with you where it will be seen as cheaper than a Pro Max or an Ultra. So it's not really a competitor to them, is it?
Exactly.
So then you end up comparing it to the regular S21 or the, you know, 13 or maybe the regular 13 Pro. And then it, you know, starts looking like, that's quite expensive actually then, you know, because you start making unfair comparisons in your head. So like I said, it's all a psychological point, but it is a funny position to be in.
With the marketing they're going for here, they want the main Pixel 6 to be like everyone can get on board with this phone. And I think it's true. It's just they're still going to have, even with the extra marketing budget, I think they're going to have a hard time convincing people that this is that phone. Mm-hmm. The Pro, meanwhile, is still really just trying to be their king of the hill, their flagship. And that pricing actually, I think, hurts it more than helps it. Mm-hmm. Because of this whole psychological thing and what they're putting up against, like by saying Tensor does really good like specific tasks, so you can't really compare it with those super high-end flagships that people really do look at the numbers for. It's a harder sell, even though it is actually really, really good.
You kind of want them to charge another 100 and just find like one or two more bells and whistles to throw in.
Charge another 100 quid, you know? Get rid of that plastic cap on top.
Uh-huh.
Maybe make it 45 watt charging.
Yeah, faster charging would obviously be welcome.
Battery life is exceptional though, but it's massive. It's
one of the 5,000 battery. It's negative, really.
Yes, they both are slow by modern standards. Slow charging, especially for flagship phones. But it's the same as the iPhone, same as Samsung. Samsung's the exact same thing.
Yeah, but not Xiaomi. Xiaomi's got that down.
Yeah,
and you've got to buy the 25 quid adapter because they're not in the box.
Yeah, again, same as Apple and same as Samsung. So in a way, the people it's trying to compete against, especially in the US marketplace where those are really its only competitors, it just doesn't matter. Like the companies it's competing with have those exact same weak spots. So, which I imagine is part of the reason none of them have felt a real impetus to change, because in the US at least, none of them have to change. None of their competition is beating them on that front. It's just in the rest of the world that they have that problem. But yeah, certainly for me, that's something that would make me a little hesitant, because I'm a big fan of really fast charging, and it's changed the way I don't charge phones overnight anymore. And that's because I'm used to very fast charging, and it would give me pause to drop a grand on a phone that I knew I would have to leave it plugged in for quite a while to get it back up to full.
It's over 2 hours for a full charge on this, which is not, that's like so slow.
Yeah, it is, you know, the one heartache I have with my beloved Z Flip 3 is it's even worse. It's 15 watt charging, which is terrible.
And I guess another thing is storage as well. Like, I have no qualms with the 128 gigabyte base storage, but the 256 and the 512 gigabyte options are pretty limited in terms of which markets internationally you can get those.
Yeah, and it's not expandable, right?
And it's non-expandable, but then Pixels have been non-expandable. And they are tied.
Yeah, they're tied to certain colors as well, depending on where.
Yeah, which is always a bit annoying.
Always a little frustrating. Yeah. Right, well, we better wrap it for there. This has been a bumper hour and a half episode, just about. So thank you, Chris, for joining with your thoughts on the 6. I think it's fair to say we are fans of these phones. My biggest headache with these is that I really don't like the way they look. And I know that's super subjective. So if you're one of the people out there who disagrees with me and thinks they do look nice, then I think these would be a really compelling option and sit right at the top of any best Android phone or best camera phone ranking, realistically. I just personally wish they didn't look the way they do. But there you go. We will be back same time, same place next week as ever. I don't know what we're going to talk about next week. Some blissful state of ignorance about what's happening over the next 7 days in the tech world.
I would say October's over. Down, but that's dumb to say. Because
as long as we don't talk about Black Friday.
Never. I don't ever want to talk about Black Friday on the show. You even ruined it just by bringing it up, Chris. Don't do that again. I won't let you back.
Leave.
You're
now.
Not going to do like live deals during the podcast.
I really hope it doesn't come to that. We will have to. We will have an episode for the Eve Black Friday Eve.
Us crying.
Yeah, we would have been doing it for a day, for a little while already,
weeping inconsolably for an hour and a half.
Weeks have run out by that point.
I'll be eating turkey and watching NFL. So
that sounds better.
Yeah, I'm jealous now.
Maybe we can do a live stream of Chris eating turkey and watching NFL instead.
Doing my Thanksgiving day off.
Yeah. Well, we're crying in the corner.
Anyway, thank you to everyone who has been watching and listening. We will be back next week to talk about something or other. We'll figure it out when we get there. Until then, goodbye. Thank you.
Bye.
See ya.